Hello everyone and welcome back. So far we talk about distinguishers, which are actually statistical weaknesses in ciphers. And as an example, we talk about differential distinguishers of the present block cipher. Then we moved on to attacks, which are key recovery attacks. And as an example, we focused on differential attacks on present block cipher. So a natural question arises when we do this stuff. The question is, how many data do I need to perform this attack, right? So this leads us to the topic of data complexity. Data complexity is important because the amount of data you use actually determines amount of time complexity you need, because you perform all of your operations on these data. And it also determines your memory complexity, because it also determines which kind of data and how many data you need to store in the memory. But data complexity is related with the success probability, because so far we mentioned that most of the cryptanalytic techniques are statistical attacks. So there's some probability involved. So once you use these properties and perform an attack, then your attack will work with some probability. So this is actually what we call a success probability. And in general, we actually expect an attack to work with more than 50% chance. So this is why you need to be able to determine the success probability of your attack. And again, this success probability will actually give you the data complexity, which is the amount of data you need to perform the attack. So in order for us to see the theory behind it, let's focus again at a toy example, which I asked a few lectures ago. Let's recall the example, the exercise, and then think about the solution. So recall that the question was as follows. You are given a dice and you are allowed to roll it to see the results as many times as you want. You are asked to determine if the dice you have is a fair dice or it is a biased dice which rolls 6 with probability 1 over 3. So what would you do? So we assume that the dice has 6 sides. So this is a 6-sided dice. So for the fair dice, the probability of rolling 6 is 1 over 6. And for the biased dice, we are given the insider information, which tells us that the probability of rolling 6 for a biased dice is 1 over 3. So it is 2 times highly likely to roll 6 on the biased dice compared to the fair dice. So as you can see, this information saying that rolling 6 has probability 1 over 3 is actually the distinguisher we find for the ciphers. So what would you do? The answer is as follows. Of course, you can roll the, so you are given the dice, but you don't know if it is fair or biased. What you can do is as follows. You can roll it as many times as you want and record how many times you see 6, right? For instance, if you roll it 6 times for the fair dice, you expect a single roll of 6. Recall that this is a binomial distribution and the expected value is the number of trials times the probability. So if you roll it 6 times, 6 times 1 over 6 is 1. So you expect only a single 6. And if it is a biased dice, the expected value becomes 6 times 1 over 3, which is 2. So you expect 2 times, you expect to see 6 2 times. But assume that you chosen to repeat this experiment, as I said, for rolling it 6. So in this content, your data complexity will be actually 6. So you are choosing it as 6. But assume that you roll the dice 6 times and you observed 5 many 6s. So you will say that, okay, this looks like a biased dice. And if you roll in a different scenario, if you roll it 6 times and if you don't see any 6s, you will say that, okay, this looks like a biased dice. But the question is, what is your success probability in these decisions? And more importantly, can you trust your decision if you roll it 6 times and you observe only single 6? And if you say that this is fair, but it might be also the biased dice. I'm trying to tell you that rolling it 6 times is a really a small number, so it is not a good choice. So what you can do is as follows. You can choose it a lot higher. For instance, assume that you are rolling it 6 million times. Now, the expected value for the fair dice becomes 1 million, and the expected value for the biased dice becomes 2 million. So these are huge numbers, and the difference are really huge. So if you perform this experiment, and if you observe a value that is close to 2 million, you will say that this is a biased dice. And if it is close to 1 million, you will say that it is a fair dice. But now we are doing an overkill here, because nobody would have the energy to roll a dice 6 million times. So it is too much. So the question is, can I find an optimum value so that I can distinguish these two dice with a very high probability? So recall that I plotted in a few previous videos, I plotted all of both of these binomial distributions in a graph and tell you how to calculate non-detection probability and false alarm probability. But let me remind you what they were again. False alarm is that if you say that this dice is biased, but if it is not, you will say that this is a false alarm because you thought that it was biased, but it is not. And if it is biased, and if you think that it is fair because you rolled it a few times and it looked like a fair dice, and if you say that it's fair, this would mean that it is a non-detection. So we need to determine the probabilities of these cases so that if they are really close to zero, you can conclude that this attack works with high probability. So let's give some notation, and then we will see what people do in the literature. So let's say that P is the probability of the distinguisher. I'm saying it for the wrong key, and P0 is the probability of the distinguisher for the correct key. If we are performing a distinguishing attack, so in that scenario, remember that we are trying to distinguish a black box from a random permutation and the cipher we are attacking. So in that case, just forget this wrong key and correct key terms. In that scenario, we are trying to distinguish two things, and the probabilities would be P would be the probability of observing that distinguisher for a random permutation, and P0 would be the probability of seeing it for the cipher that we are going to attack. But we make a generalization here. So as recall that in the previous exercise, we were trying to capture 40-bit secret key of the present cipher. So in that attack, you have 2 to the 40 possible candidates for the secret key, but only one of them is correct. And 2 to the 40 minus one of them are wrong keys. So the wrong keys would follow a different binomial distribution, and the correct key would follow a different distribution, because we are assuming that correct key would satisfy that distinguisher. And here we are making an assumption and saying that let's assume that all of the wrong keys are assuming like a random permutation. So this is called a wrong key randomization hypothesis. So we are assuming that the probability P, which is also the probability of observing the distinguisher for a random permutation, is also valid for the wrong keys, but the probability of observing it for the correct key is something else, which is actually the probability of the distinguisher you calculate when you find that weakness in the cipher. So I mentioned that there are two probabilities to be concerned, false alarm probability and non-detection probability. Now we define two more numbers, and is the number of data actually you need to perform the attack. So this can be something you choose. You may again recall the dice example. You can roll the dice 6 million times or 6 times, but once you fix the N, the probability of false alarm and probability of non-detection changes. But we can look at the problem in a different way. Maybe we can fix probability of false alarm and non-detection. So you can say that, okay, I want to perform the attack. I want to choose N so that the probability of false alarm is 1 over 1,000 and probability of non-detection is 1 over 1,000. So what N should be? So there are some algorithms to answer this question. So you can look at the problem in different ways. But in all of these scenarios, recall that when I was mentioning the two different binomial distributions to distinguish. Recall that in the previous example, we said that the expected values are different for both cases. So for the wrong key, the expected value is n times p, and for the correct key, it is n times p zero. So you might say that, okay, I will just calculate the point in the middle of this. So if it is higher than this threshold, I can say that it is the correct key. And if it's less than that, I will say that it is the wrong key. So you actually need to choose a threshold, and it doesn't have to be always something in the middle. So it is also a variable. So we denote this threshold with T. That is threshold used to decide whether the key counter is a candidate or not. Okay. So let's move on. Okay, let's recall what is our perception here. We can look at the problem in two different ways. We can we might be given the values n, p, and p0. So p and p0 are actually something fixed, because once you find the distinguisher, you calculate p0 yourself, and you also calculate how likely that to happen for a random permutation, which is the probability p. So these are actually fixed. So if you also fix n, now you might ask, what is the success probability of the attack? So in this scenario, you might calculate the probability of false alarm and probability of false detection. But you can look at it in a different way. You can again calculate P and P0 because you find the distinguisher, but then you might choose yourself P, probability of non-detection, and probability of false alarm, and then ask, how many pairs do I need to perform this attack so that these probabilities are valid? So let's see how we calculate those probabilities actually. So think about it in this way. We have n pairs, and the distinguisher is observed with probabilities p and p0. Again, we have two binomial distributions. So we are actually trying to distinguish two binomial distributions with parameters mp and mp0. Of course, I'm saying two binomial distributions here in the scenario when you are trying to when you're performing actually a distinguishing attack. So if you're trying to distinguish if this is the cipher you are attacking or a random permutation, this sentence is correct. But if you're attacking 40-bit key, then actually there is a single correct key and 2 to the 40 minus 1 wrong key. So there you are trying to actually distinguish one binomial distribution of n p0 and 2 to the 40 minus 1 binomial distributions MP, which actually becomes a little bit harder to think about. But so for the sake of clarity, let's assume that we are actually looking at the distinguishing attack first. So we have two binomial distributions with these parameters. Now we need to calculate what are the probabilities of non-detection or false alarm. So let's look at MP0. So this is a binomial distribution. So I assume that we put a threshold. So the probability of this binomial distribution, where the number of the probability of observing this distinguisher with values less than t, are actually the summation of the left lower dots, the probabilities on a binomial distribution graph. So this is actually the summation from I equals to zero to T. T is your threshold, and you are actually calculating the since you are summing all of these probabilities, it is written like this. But I think there's a typo here. The small n is actually the capital N. So sorry for that. So because if you want to see the distinguisher I many times, since it happens with probability p0, you get p0 to the I times 1 minus p0 to the m minus I with n choice I. And this is a summation from 0 to t. So you can calculate this value. But the problem is that in theoretical attacks, we are dealing with very huge numbers and very small probabilities. For instance, for a block size, a block cipher with block size of b bits, most of the time this n is something close to 2 to the b. So for instance, for president, this can be close to 2 to the 64. So assume that n is 2 to the 64 here, and the probabilities are very close to 2 to the minus 64. He called it in Wang's attack, this was 2^-62. So then try to perform all of these operations and you will realize that you don't have enough computational power or memory to perform these operations in a naive way. So we should come up with some estimates instead of performing this summation. So there are two work that I generally focus on. One of them belongs to Ali Aydin-Selçuk. So Ali Aydin-Selçuk uses the fact that binomial distribution can be approximated by normal distribution when n is large enough. And in our scenario, n is really large enough. His formulas provide good success probability approximations for differential and linear cryptanalysis when the inputs np and p0 are provided. So once you give these values, Selçuk's algorithm tells you that this attack would work with probability 99.3% or something. But what he does is as follows. Instead of making this summation, since he turns this binomial distribution into some kind of a normal distribution, in the normal distribution, this summation actually turns into an integral. And calculating an area and taking the integral is a lot easier than performing all of these summation operations. But of course, this is not that simple. In the paper, he makes a lot of modification, a lot of estimates and so on. But at the end, he gives a formula to calculate these probabilities. And more recent work by Blondet, Garrett and Tillich uses approximations for binomial distribution. So instead of converting or approximating a binomial distribution from a normal distribution, what they do is to come up with good approximations for the binomial distribution itself. They actually use formulas from a very old biology paper, I guess. But their algorithm works like this. Their algorithm takes input as P, P0, PFA, and PND. So you give all of the probabilities yourself. And the algorithm tells you where to put your threshold and how many data you need. So you might think that this might be more useful because you can play with probability of false alarm and non-detection again and again and calculate different n's and t's. But same thing applies for Selçuk's formula. Once you give the n and p and p0, if the result says that your success probability is really small, like 10%, you might increase n and run the formula again and see how it works. But as far as I know, in differential attacks, approximations of this work somewhat closer to the real value than Selçuk's work, which actually they give some examples in a table, which I actually copied from here and put it in the slides. But before giving the algorithm itself, let me how they obtain this result. They use, again, as I told you, an approximation from a different work. And in that work, they use Kullback-Leibler divergence. So let me first define what a Kullback-Leibler divergence is. So let P and Q be two Bernoulli probability distributions of respective parameters P and Q. The Kullback-Leibler divergence between P and Q is defined with this notation, such that it is P times ln P over Q plus 1 minus P times ln 1 minus P divided by 1 minus Q. Of course, this natural logarithm actually depends on the work. So in our case, we are actually dealing with bits. So here, actually, this ln would be log 2 because we will be performing our operations in base 2. So the logarithms will be logarithm 2 in our case. So this is the general definition. Note that 0 times ln 0 divided by p equals to 0, and p times ln p over 0 is assumed to be infinity. These are just conventions based on the continuity arguments. So if you implement it yourself, this would give a divide by 0 compile error. This is why you need to actually predefine these definitions, but most of the time you wouldn't observe this. So let's see what happens. Recall that our aim was to put a threshold in our two binomial distributions, and for the false alarm, for the non-detection, we have to calculate the probabilities less than this threshold, and for the false alarm, we have to calculate the probabilities larger than this. So in this scenario, we see that two different versions. So when the this tau times n actually is the threshold, the algorithm they run gives you tau, but once you multiply it with n, you get the threshold t. So the probability that the for the random permutation to get something higher than the threshold value, the sum of all of these summation values, is determined with this simple formula. But of course, it is not exactly, it is just an approximation. As you can see, there are just multiplication and square root operations here. And at the power of e, you observe that you get some Kullback-Leibler divergence. And for the non-detection probability, for the binomial distribution of the cipher, we need to sum, if you go back, we need to sum all of these values from 0 to t. And this is actually given by, this is, all of this probability, summation of all of these probabilities from 0 to threshold t. And it is given like this. So they look very similar, but only the probabilities and their orders change. So if you calculate this, this is just for for a given value, but I told you that since you don't know the threshold initially, you cannot calculate this probability without knowing the tau, right? So our aim was to actually find this tau and n values. So what they do is as follows. Since we don't know that value, they perform a binary search-like algorithm to find that value. So your lower bound is zero. You choose a very high upper bound, for instance, for a block size of b bits, you choose 2 to the b, and your binary search algorithm starts in the middle, which is 2 to the b minus 1. So you perform this operation, this probability for that value, and if it is too much, then you go below it. If it is too low, you go above it. So this way you perform a binary search, and here is the algorithm for that. So this GND and GFA actually are the formulas I mentioned here. So in that scenario, it becomes very simple. This is actually two binary searches inside each other. And as you can see, the input is error probabilities, this false alarm and non-detection with probabilities P0 and P. And the algorithm gives you the output N, the data you need, and the relative threshold, which is actually, once you multiply this value with n, would give you the capital T, which I defined earlier. So this algorithm is from the work by Selim Blondu, Beno Gerard, and Jean-Pierre Tillich from a paper published in Designs, Codes, and Cryptography with the title Accurate Estimates of the Data Complexity and Success Probability for Various Cryptanalysis. So in the same paper, they give a table to show us how the results compare to previous results. So if I'm not mistaken, this 11 is the work by Serge Vodne, and this 12 by Alaaddin Selçuk. These are the real values, and these are the results they obtain from the formulas I just mentioned. So they provide some test cases where they defined P and P0 and probability of false alarm and probability of non-detection, and see what these algorithms give you as the N, which is the number of data units. So these are actually in logarithm 2. So they say that you need 2 to the 47.57 plaintext pairs to perform a linear attack, where the probability for a random permutation, the probability is 0.5, and the bias for the cipher is 1.49 times 2 to the minus 24. And here they chose the probability of non-detection and probability of false alarm as 10%. So this is the real value they calculated. This is the result of their algorithm, and these are the results from the literature. So they're trying to show that their results are really close to the correct values in different cryptanalysis techniques like linear differential and truncated differential attacks, as you can see, compared to the, you know, previous results given by Serge Vodnay and Alaaddin Selçuk. So, but of course, also I gave the algorithm as simple as this, but in practice, implementing it might be a little bit hard because you need a big integer libraries and small, big floating point arithmetic libraries, because our probabilities are really small and are really large. So I don't know if you can implement this in Python and expect the result in a reasonable time. But in C, most of the time I get a result in less than a minute on a standard laptop. But again, correctly implementing it might be a very hard for the beginners.